Well, hello there, it's Antrice, and welcome to another episode of the Savvy Painter Podcast. The Savvy Painter Podcast is published every other week. If you are a painter who is looking for down-to-earth, real-life conversations about art, how to create it, and how to sell it, you are in the right place. Savvy Painter has been downloaded over 1.5 million times by artists in 150 countries. This is the place where you will find your community. You'll be inspired to create, and you'll hear real stories from artists who are thriving with their art. So if you are new to this podcast, I want to welcome you to the Savvy Painter community. But make sure that you don't miss an episode. Sign up for weekly updates, free guides, and workshop announcements. Just go to savvypainter.com/subscribe. It's that easy. My guest this week on the Savvy Painter podcast is Nicolas Uribe. Nicolas began his studies at the School of Visual Arts with comic book illustration, but after watching Stephen Assale do a demo on his first day in the painting studio, everything changed. Nicolas studied with Stephen Assale and Max Ginsburg and then left to work in an illustration house in New York City. Eventually, Nicolas moved to Colombia. For the last 15 years or so, he has based his life and work out of the capital city of Bogota. In this episode, Nicolas and I talk about passing the torch, the impact of a great teacher on students, and vice versa, how students challenge teachers and help them grow. Nicolas also talks about his decision and strategy to learn about color, not just the basics, but how to deeply understand it. He shares how he sees his own evolution as an artist and how he fosters continual growth in his work. And finally, we talk about artists getting typecast, and on the flip side, what artists can do to avoid comparison when they want to paint a subject another artist is well known for. So please enjoy this episode of the Savvy Painter Podcast with Nicolas Uribe. Nicolas, welcome to the Savvy Painter Podcast. I'm really delighted to have you on the show today.
Thank you, Antrice. I'm delighted. I'm a fan of the podcast. I've listened to it for a while now, so I'm happy to be here.
Oh, thanks. I would love to hear from you. Was there an artist that you admired when you were young that inspired you to be a painter yourself?
The strange thing in my case is that I didn't contemplate being a painter until I was in Steve Assale's painting class in college. I mean, if I have to go back, you know, my mother would have to be that person because she would, you know, she's an artist. She's the one person that from the beginning said, you know, if you want to draw, draw and really enjoy drawing. She never like put anything in front of me like a still life or anything. And she said, you know, draw this and think about contour or light or form. She never did anything like that. She just let me be. But she was like 100% support, no judgment whatsoever, you know, no feeling of being embarrassed by calling yourself an artist. So she was definitely the most important. I mean, her and my father, but definitely, you know, she was this driving force behind, you know, me wanting to feel comfortable or me acknowledging that I could feel comfortable just saying that I wanted to be an artist from a really young age. But then I guess in school, I don't know, it would have to be Steve, because
if you weren't sure you were going to be an artist, how did you end up in Steve's class? Or were you just so...
I went into SVA, to School of Visual Arts, but to do comic books, actually.
Ah.
Yeah, I loved illustration. And I loved like sci-fi stuff. I remember when I was really young, I would look at like Frazetta's book, Frank Frazetta.
Uh-huh.
I have an older brother. He had some books lying around. And I loved that. That was amazing. I've always said that was like almost like pornography for an artist, you know, and I was really, really young. I was probably like, you know, 7, 8 years old looking at like these Frazetta paintings. And obviously it's like objectifying of women and everything. But in terms of like just imagination, it just blew my mind. So I knew I loved that. And I thought, well, I could do comic books. But I came into SVA and I realized how horrible I was at like visual storytelling. Because what you don't realize in comic books is that you can like superheroes. Sometimes you say comic books and people immediately think of like superheroes. What you don't realize is that it's actually a visual storytelling medium. And what I didn't realize is that I sucked at telling a story through panels and vignettes and all these things. I just didn't have the feeling for it.
When did that become clear to you?
As soon as I got in, I was like, oh my God, I just don't have what you need to be good at this. And I felt there was such a precipice between what I thought a comic book artist, you know, had to be, and what my other like fellow students were actually, you know, very conscious of what a real comic book artist was. And I just said, you know, I just don't have this in me. I just don't. I saw my friends and I was like, they have it, but I just don't. So I was very nervous for a little bit because I just didn't know if I could just turn off a switch and say, okay, I'll do something else within, you know, the arts. But I went, you know, through the, I guess it was logical route. And it was just saying, okay, well, if I can't tell a story with a collection of images, I can probably tell it with one image. And that's actually what I always enjoyed. And I thought that was illustration. So I changed majors and I went to illustration, and you had to take like painting. I think there was like studio credits and you had to take painting. And I had no idea who Steve was. I had absolutely no idea. And I just signed up for his class. You know, it's not like today that you can kind of Google somebody and say, okay, I like my teacher. This was a book, you know, this was just a big, big book. And I just saw the painting classes and I was like, okay, he sounds fine. So it was just luck, I guess. And first class, which was very weird, which I thought was extremely weird. The first class, as soon as I went in, Steve was already painting, which was strange. I was like, I'm here thinking that, you know, they were going to talk about materials, you know, and, you know, what you're supposed to bring. And people were already working because they were used to just doing the same class like every semester. And Steve was painting and I was like, oh my God. And I saw him paint. And I remember I probably didn't even drop my bag. I was like, this is what I want to do. And I just probably was like standing behind him with many other people. And I just looked at him and said, okay, this is it. This is exactly what I want to do. And, you know, it was that I felt was like a switch. And it's been like that ever since. Like I fell in love with exactly what he was doing at that moment. And just understanding that that could be a career, that that could be my life was perfect. It was just perfect. So eventually I ended up taking his classes like over and over and over again, which is really cool about art school. At least like an SVA, you could just take, you know, you had studio credits, but you could just repeat the class if you liked it for as long as you want. And I took his class forever. And I took Max Ginsburg's class also. And it was both of them that they really kind of brought it home. It was very nice because Max was actually Steve's teacher when he was younger. So it was perfect. It just felt like it was right.
Like the torch was being handed down.
Right, exactly. Like you felt like there was painting could be something that could be understood by generations apart. And they loved it. I mean, they absolutely respected and loved painting. And they were both like very successful professionals. So you kind of saw the big spectrum of possibilities. Like you could actually paint, but you could actually make a living off of it. And you could be satisfied and you could teach and give back. It was very nice. And to this day, I have a lot of love for them and appreciation for what they meant, you know, for me. I started teaching really looking for the... just that same feeling I got when I saw Steve paint. It was just that sense of wonder. Like
it's like magic or something, right? It's like you're sitting there and you're kind of like, this is, I don't have words for that feeling when you're watching, especially at that age when you're watching sort of like a master.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I was 17 turning 18 because I started young in school. If you would have asked me back then, I wouldn't have been able to tell you like exactly how to describe that feeling. But what I knew was that it just gave me a sense of like, this is it. You know, this is exactly it. This is what you were looking for. Like, this gives you a sense of like place and security. And this is what your life is supposed to be. And I've always, I mean, this is very almost grandiose and pretentious, but I always thought maybe I want to spur that feeling in other people. If Steve did that for me, I always thought, wow, maybe I could do that for someone else, which I don't think I have. Let's, you know, get that out of the way. I don't think my students, and I've been teaching for 12 years now here in university here in the fine arts faculty here in Bogota. And yeah, I'm not frustrated by it, but I know how hard it is to just be that spark for somebody else. And I hope I've had like, I've become like somebody who's important in that moment of their development. And that's, you know, that's all I want. But yeah, I wish that at some point in my life, I can be that person for somebody else. Cause it was, to me, they were incredibly important, you know, and they came in like at the right moment. So
That is the magic of being able to pass that on and have that reception with regards to your capabilities, I guess, which makes it sound so clinical. But I was able to go visit Wayne Thiebaud and...
Oh, he's amazing.
Yeah. And you know what struck me the most about that was how important it is to him to do what you just said, to teach and to pass the torch, and how much his students mean to him and how much it sparks him and his own. I mean, it's Wayne Thiebaud. He's Wayne Thiebaud, and he's 98 years old. He's been painting for 70 years. And we're in his studio and we're seeing his painting. And then he basically, like, there's a couple of us there and he gathers us around and says, "What do you think about my painting?" And there's this stunned silence that he's actually asking. And not just for show, but he's generally interested in what the students think of his paintings. And he sort of mentioned that his time with his students is the highlight of his, you know, it's like his happy place almost. So I'm sure, I don't know, I just kind of feel like you don't know as an instructor the impact that you've had usually, I think, until much later. Like, I'm sure it wasn't for years that before you were able to, for example, tell Steve what impact he had on you, or was it?
Oh, right. Yeah, yeah. And it's very strange because there's this moment where you have to detach yourself from your teachers, where you have to understand that, you know, what they've taught you was just information that you have to put to test, and you have to, you know, many times you'll agree with like a bunch of stuff that they told you, and many times you go like, oh, they're so crazy. But, you know, when you are a teacher, you realize that's what you want to do. I mean, I want the exact same thing for my students. I want them to question the things I say in order for them to eventually become, you know, the artist that they have to become. So at some point, and it was probably like 2 years later, 2 years after I graduated, for me, I had to almost like exercise like the demons that come from just being really, really close to like your instructors, your teachers, and to being like super fond of what they do. And sometimes you convince yourself that, you know, what my teacher is telling me is exactly who I am. Like, I agree with him or her in exactly every single word that they're saying. I just feel like we are part of like the same team. And whenever I see their paintings, it's like, oh, I would have done the same thing. And the truth is, no, you know, we're totally different people. And for me, it took me a while. It was probably 2 years after I graduated that I started to question those things. And it probably took me 2-3 years after that to eventually start to feel comfortable like in my own skin and to start to understand myself as a painter. So it does take some time. I don't think those things are automatic, but it's funny because at some level, you just tell your teachers, you know, I need you out of my head and out of my life right now. But there's this underlying sense of like respect and love. And for me, it's just a joy that I was able to have them be part of my life and to have had the opportunity to learn from them. That's never going to change. For example, Max Ginsberg, I love him. I absolutely adore him. I used to tell him that he was like, him and Miriam, his wife, were my family outside my home because they were like so kind to me when I was there. But, you know, at some point I was like, okay, I got to forget about Max.
Yeah, you have to leave the nest, so to speak. How did you handle that? Because I get that question from a lot of people when, you know, and it can be years later and they still haven't quite figured out how to get those voices out of their heads. How did you approach that?
It eventually was helpful. The fact that I moved out of New York and I came back home, I didn't need to. I'm an American citizen. I was born in the US. So, you know, I could have stayed in New York for as long as I wanted. I was happy living there, but I realized that, you know, I was having trouble. I was working as an illustrator and I was having trouble just fitting the painting that I wanted to do and the work that I had to do. And I kind of told myself, I have to move back home because it's the only place where I'm going to be able to just paint what I want to paint.
Home being Colombia.
Bogota, Colombia. So I told myself, I have to go back home. And I thought I knew what I wanted to do, but the truth is I didn't. You know, but I started convincing myself that, you know, whatever I was looking for, I had to go back home. I have to come back home to do it.
Was that an economic choice or a creative choice or a combination?
I think it was more creative because I was doing really well. I mean, I was working on an illustration studio and those are very strange. Those existed like in the 60s and 70s, but for one to exist in the late 90s and 2000s was very, very weird.
Yeah, that is strange. Because that was about the time that stock illustration was kind of destroying that market.
Right, right. And usually agencies that maybe have like illustrations, like a couple of illustrators in there. But this was, we were all illustrators working at like one studio. It was an awesome job. I even friends that I, and people that I worked with, what is it like, you know, more than 15 years ago, they're still there. So it's a very stable, good job. I was doing fine.
It still exists.
Yeah, it still exists.
Wow.
Yeah.
Sorry to the people who are working there. That just.
No, that's awesome. I mean, if that was exactly what I wanted to do with my life, I would have been so happy there. It was like a great family there. So, you know, I would have never left. But the thing is, I that's not what I wanted to do. I wanted to be a painter.
So what were you looking for when you went back to Bogota in terms of, you know, the creative aspect?
For one time, I really had no notion of just handling my own time because I had to work. You know, I was working maybe like 12-hour days, a little more than that. It was like really, really tough, the work hours of that studio. And I was only able to paint like in the weekends. So the first thing I was just, oh, thank you for this. It was time. It was just time to be patient, time to think things through, time to reflect upon what I wanted to do. And that was very, very important. And I was grateful because I had made like enough money that I brought a bunch of money, you know, here to Bogota. And I think I lived off of that money for like a year, maybe, or a year and a half. And I was like, okay, I can spend, you know, this money. I have a year and a half to just think and paint, and we'll see what happens after that. But what I realized when I started painting, it was like, you know, what I was just describing, it was like, I still have my teachers like buzzing in my head. And for me, it was, I started questioning every single step of the execution of a painting, every single one. So the most obvious ones being, I have to put these colors down in my palette or I'm painting with these brushes. I even questioned those. And that was super important for me. I realized that I could paint like Max or like Steve, but for example, I knew nothing about color. And this sounds very weird, but that's something that's totally, you know, plausible. Like I was just emulating what they did. And I was just kind of reminding myself of what they did when they solved certain things. And that was exactly what was in my arsenal. Like I was very aware of how they solved different problems. And I could like invoke those manners of resolving when I was trying to paint. But I realized that I myself didn't really understand how to solve anything. And I'm not being like hyperbolic here. I was like, I don't get color. I understand why Steve mixes this and this and this for light and this and this and this for shadow. And if he's painting artificial light, then he does this. Or I understand why Max would use this and this to paint that particular skin tone. But I was like, you know, if I have to explain it to somebody, I just don't know how to explain it.
At that point, if you had to explain it to somebody, would you have said, take, you know, this much white and add a little dab of cad yellow and add a little, you know, like it would have been basically, here's the recipe to make.
Exactly. I would have just been reciting a recipe that I knew, but I had no clue what those parts meant for that recipe. Why is there flour in this recipe? I don't know. You just put flour in it.
Right.
And that was the extent of my knowledge. I realized I was painting, you know, in spite of my ignorance. And that was very frustrating for me. That was incredibly frustrating for me. You know, nowadays I've noticed that people just don't want to deal with accepting the fact that we may be very ignorant on many respects of our process. And I went like head on and I said, no, I really have to tackle these things, even though it's going to hurt. And I started from scratch. Like I started, you know, doing grisailles, and I started doing value exercises again. I started reading a ton of books and going into like painting forums and asking stupid questions about mediums and paint and technique. And then I realized that, yes, my experience was helping me understand those things a little more, I guess, deeply.
Uh-huh.
But I really felt like, you know, I'm starting to paint again, once again. Like I have to relearn a bunch of stuff that I thought I understood. And I went through that process, and it was, I tell this story, but Steve Bissell's palette is usually like 20 some odd colors.
Wow, it's a ton.
Right. And I had no clue. I remember just squeezing so many colors, and I was like, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm just squeezing colors here. But, and you know, I would look around and I would say, well, you know, this guy mixed these for the shadow and it seems to work. And then I would look to my right and I was like, wow, this girl mixed these for light and it seems to work. So I'll do that. But that was it. You know, I scraped them all off. I even, you know, this is kind of ridiculous, but 20 years later, I still have some of the colors that I used in Steve's class because I've never used them again. And I started with, you know, very simple, like color theory with very limited palettes. And that has helped, you know, a ton, even like to this day that I'm quite comfortable now teaching color and light and form. I think it all kind of started just by that attitude, by that little moment where I started questioning everything.
So when you were in that place where you had to learn about color, because we don't know what we don't know. Like I know how I learned color and I know all the exercises that I had to do. And I know it's always interesting, right? That there were some students who were just like, oh my God, this sucks. I hate this. I don't want to have to paint another value scale or another color scale or do another like painting in that key with that complementary system or whatever it is. But that was that feeling that you talk about when you watch Steven paint. To me, like the only way to verbalize that feeling is it's almost like falling in love. It's just like, you know, this huge, like this, everything about this is awesome. And I want this for the rest of my life. Right.
Right, right, right.
But still, like, I know there's a million things that I don't know about color. So how did you figure out what you didn't know? You know, I mean, so you had this sense that it sounds like you sort of developed this habit of almost mixing colors by rote, by just kind of like pulling bits of recipes and bringing them together to create a meal or a painting. But how did you, so first question is, how did you discover what you didn't know, what specifically you needed to know? I mean, and then how did you train yourself to do that?
I think intent was, and still to this day, I feel is the most important aspect of painting or of being an artist, really, or like a human being, just having a reason for doing things. The reason could be just absolutely formal and technical. And yes, you know, you can do those sort of exercises. But in that sense, you could do like, you know, color theory that comes from Bauhaus, which is like the color theory that tons of people teach. And there you're doing just exercises to understand like the nature of color and how it behaves when it's, you know, put in it, when you create different relationships between other colors. But I think those are absolutely formal and those are very important. Like you were saying, I did so many charts, so many color charts, so many just permutations of mixes and, you know, almost like those Richard Schmidt charts.
Yeah.
Where you have like a dominant color. He would do one for every single color in his palette.
Yeah.
And he would say, okay, this is, I have, I don't know, permanent rose, let's say. And I'll see, you know, what happens when permanent rose is my dominant hue in the mixtures of all my palette, like within my palette. And he would do all that and create this really nice harmony. I think I did all of those. And then I started pushing myself saying, okay, let's do a painting with complementaries and with split complementaries. And so I'm trying everything. I'm trying like anything that I found that said, you know, this is a color harmony and it works because they're adjacent or it works because they're, you know, right across each other or, you know, all that stuff I tried out. But eventually I realized that if there's not a drive behind wanting to paint that painting in orange and blue, then you don't get it. Then you know, you're only getting
God,
part
I was
of
such
it.
A geek.
Yeah, but you know, when you're doing that, it's like, fine, it kind of works. And you say, oh, it kind of works. But it won't really activate until you really want to say something within those colors or within, you know, a value range or within a specific harmony. And as soon as I was able to understand that I had to attach a reason behind wanting to paint within like specific, you know, parameters in a value exercise or in a color exercise, then that made sense. I was like, oh my God, this is incredible. So if I spoke about saturation, I mean, you were saying about Thibaut, like Wayne Thibaut, you know, his cakes and all his like pastries and stuff. I mean, those colors are like super nice and rich. I mean, they have to feel like pastries and saturated. It has to, like, color can't be like his understanding of color is, it can't be detached from what he's painting, from his subject matter and from how he perceives his subject matter and how he wants to present his subject matter. So that to me was crucial, that I couldn't just make exercises like in a vacuum. And, you know, you can do those. You can spend hundreds of hours doing those. And those are excellent. And I'm sure they'll provide you with information about your palette, information about color. Mm-hmm. But again, that is just information. And at some level, that information just won't really click and won't really like activate.
Right.
If there's not a painting that's saying, okay, now do that exercise and use me, you know, the painting is telling you, use me to portray what happens when you do this exercise.
Yeah. It's like the difference between learning a word or, you know, like basically reading a dictionary and memorizing vocabulary and writing poetry. Like you have to be able to use those words in the strongest way in exactly the right place to get the meaning that you want.
Yep. It was exactly that. So I would say what changed was just me identifying how to say, you know, what the exercise was kind of directing me to say, how to say that efficiently through painting. And it took time. I mean, some people don't really, I mean, I think people say that they understand, but, you know, when you go a little bit deeper, you realize that they don't. Like, these things take patience. And sometimes people are like, no, I get it. I'll work hard. And I know it takes time. And you're like, no, it actually really takes a lot of time and a lot of hard work and a lot of patience. Because if none of those things are part of the equation, you're not going to see results. It's, you know, that's just the way it is. So it did take time. I gave myself the time. I was very happy that I was lucky enough to produce paintings in the meantime while I was learning, and I had shows that did really well. So it was like a very nice kind of run for me, and I've been in that run for like a while, so I don't want it to stop. I don't want to jinx it. But I've always had this part of me that says, you know, I have to just keep learning, because, you know, if painting or drawing, if those things don't teach you how to be humble, you know, in the eyes of art, then nothing will. Honestly, if you've done painting for 20 years and you still think, and you think it's easy now, then you're not doing it right. It's always hard. It's always going to be hard. But that's the most fascinating part, because, you know, if it was a finite kind of development, then you reach the end and you say, okay, I get it. You know, that's how you paint. I get it. But the most just fascinating and remarkable thing about these processes is that, you know, they're so attached to your life and to your perception and, you know, everything that's contextual about you, that, you know, they evolve with you and they can be as complex as you are as a human being. So what's cool about it is that I've had the, and I think, you know, this is mainly luck. I hate to say it, but I've met so many just incredibly talented artists that don't do well that I've realized I've been lucky. I've met people that are far more talented than I am that struggle a lot. But I've been lucky. You know, I've been, when I've had shows, I do really well. And I've always said that that just buys me some more time. In my words, I've always put it like, you know, I just ask of life to just give me a chance to keep painting and to do well enough to just keep painting. That's all I ask. I don't, you know, I don't want like Damon Hirst money. I don't want Jeff Koons money. I don't need any of that. That's not what I thought painting would be in my life. That's not the space that I want painting to occupy like in my life. I just want the chance to keep going and keep going and keep going. And like you said, if I could be like 98, like Thibaut and still paint, and that's amazing. I can't think of a nicer gift that life can give you than that, just to be in love with something that gives you purpose and to keep doing it for such a long time. It's just amazing. So it's been a mixture of that. Like, I've always pushed myself to just be inquisitive and to question everything and to have like this, I have a natural curiosity for everything. If I go see a show or if I look at some paintings, I'm always like, wow, that's amazing. Like, why did that work? Like, I don't see it as, oh, I have to make a mental note of doing something similar to that, because I hate that stuff. You know, people unfortunately are very attracted to very superficial qualities of image making, and they get wrongfully enamored by an image, and that can actually distort the way you produce images. But what I usually do is just say, wow, that is so cool. Like, let me see what I learn from it and, you know, try to translate this image that works into something that I can understand, and in the sense that I can sort of quantify why it had such an impact on me, and see if in that why I can find elements that I could feed into my painting.
Mm. Talk a little bit about how you choose your subject matter. What is it that gets you totally excited and think to yourself, I'm going to paint that, or I want to set up that problem to solve?
I think I've devolved into a much simpler just way of understanding like life and the world, and hence, you know, my painting. I don't think like those two things can be separate.
Mm-hmm.
But before, I could tell you that I thought like an artist. I thought within, you know, the sort of almost like restrictions or parameters that art gives you. And I wanted to speak like an art tongue and just try to define the reasons behind what I wanted to do. And as an artist, I was always trying to find, you know, these very seemingly deep reasons, these deep conceptual reasons for doing something. So I've tried so many things. I mean, sometimes people ask me, well, how do you paint? How would you define your painting? And I have no clue how do I define. I have absolutely no idea, because I've done.
No, like, so could you, for people who have never seen your work before, who are listening to this, could you tell them what you paint?
Wow. I mean, if I had to define it, I always say I'm a contemporary naturalist. I don't know, figurative painter, maybe, but not really. That's very small, because you know, sometimes I look at my paintings and they seem incredibly abstract. And at other times I tell myself, I know nothing about color. I have no stance, you know, in terms of color. I don't want to say stuff through color. And then I go, wow, that's really nice what I did with color right there. It seems like I'm making a statement about color. So I'm sure that there's more abstract or, you know, expressionistic qualities to what I do that kind of try to encapsulate like almost like, you know, the whole of the 20th century of paintings.
That's such a small thing to capture in your painting, Nicolas.
Well, that sounds overly dramatic, but...
Well, I can see it, because, I mean, you paint figures and you're playing so... I mean, there's so many... If you look at your paintings, you see the, you know, what's kind of in front of you, what our eye is attracted to, which is usually, you know, the thing that we can recognize, the figure. But the really interesting stuff is what happens, like you're completely playing with the negative shapes and making these like crazy abstractions in there that work.
Oh, right, right. Yeah, just to round that argument, I really feel that our, if I had to say what, you know, our disease now as like traditionally probably educated painters that are painting in this contemporary sort of figurative fashion today, is that we are all, and I went through that. I think I took my medicine for that, but we're all really trying to mix everything in. I mean, this was all almost out of reach for us, because all these like different philosophies and isms, they were fighting with each other like through the 20th century. And you couldn't be like two things at the same time. It just never worked. It's like there are, you know, some thoughts behind these paintings that you can't be part of something that is like diametrically opposed to what this painting kind of entails, what this philosophy entails. And today, nobody cares. I mean, you know, there are no schools of thought in painting really nowadays. People are just, you know, there's just pluralism, and you just, you do you, you know, you pick whatever you want.
What a great time to be a painter.
Yeah, but I think we're realizing that it is great, but it's like a all-you-can-eat buffet. And, you know, eventually, if you just go there saying, I could eat anything I want, you know, you're going to puke. Eventually, right. You're going to puke. So I think we're at that moment where we're realizing, wow, we've been like super, like, for example, nowadays, we're enamored by these kind of old archive quality images that they don't really quite belong to us, but they do because we can find them in internet or we can just find them in old books and we can appropriate like them and we can use them. So you see a bunch of people just working kind of like in the manner of Gerhard Richter, and they're using like these old photographs, but putting like a very expressionistic brushstrokes and then doing something very realistic on top, or we're being kind of iconoclastic with them. So we take something that we find very precious in terms of those images, and we just really kind of go crazy on top and just try to eliminate the value. And so I think we're kind of dealing with just having all this information available to us as painters, which it really, if you think about it, it really didn't happen. I mean, this is probably more, it is closer to like the 90s and maybe early 2000s when we started to do that. So I think we're just realizing all the risks that those things kind of have, you know, within them. Like,
what are the risks that you're seeing in them?
I think we're being blinded by images. When we're looking at stuff, we're not looking deeply enough. If you look at Samori, like Nicolas Samori, or if you look at Kanevsky, it is so easy to fall for the surface quality of the images and not for what's actually almost like detonating those images, like the thoughts that are behind, you know, the image making, that I think people are just consuming, us artists, we are consuming the surface quality of the images so, so quickly that we're not, you know, we're not taking our time to just say, okay, what, you know, why does this move me? And you have to dig deeper. You can't just say, I just find it exciting, I just find it really cool, or, you know, I just love the way paint is applied. Like, all those things are important, but they are surface quality. And I think we have to take our time. So, and to go back to what I was saying at the beginning, like, I've been guilty of all those things. I don't want to sound like I'm holier than thou. Like, the reason I speak right now about devolving is because I've found myself like doing those things that I find exciting, but that really did, they just show me how much of I've been looking at other stuff for so long. I started questioning myself and saying, does this really belong to me? You know, if I looked at something and I was like, oh, I want to paint that. And, you know, I can't tell you again with like Thibaut, like when I see a pastry and I'm like, this looks so cool, I got to paint it. Uh-huh. But then I think of Thibaut or I think of Will Cotton and I'm like, you know, I'm thinking about them. I'm already seeing an image that kind of goes back to them.
Thibaut's a great example because it's really hard not to think of pastries and ice cream and not think of Thibaut. And he doesn't even do that anymore. And he hasn't for decades. But
oh, right, right. Yeah, sadly, that's what probably people are going to remember. You know, it's like Jasper Johns, like, Jasper Johns, he's painted for decades after he did like the flag or,
yeah,
or like the target or the numbers. But nobody's going to remember anything except those things. So it's very sad. Like, artwork can be cruel, can be very, very cruel.
Yeah, it's kind of like the actor who's been typecast. But let's say that you decide that you want to paint pastries, for example. Like, if you legitimately want to do it and you don't want to be another Thibaut, it seems like, I'm curious, what are your thoughts and how do you do that? It seems like you'd have to just...
You can't even have that conversation within you just saying, well, I have to make it like different from his.
Right. Because it can't be not Thibaut.
Yeah. But even if that thought is in you, then you're starting at the wrong place. Because then it's still in you. You're still very aware. You're still painfully aware of what he did.
Right.
Or if you want to do gumball machines, and if you think of his, or if you think of the ones that were done in the like photorealism in the 60s and 70s, that can't be part of your thought process. Ideally, what you want is to be so detached from that that you don't really think about those things. That you just say, I am drawn to this because I really feel I have a reason for painting this. Like, this is so close to my life. I know I can speak about this in a way that nobody else can because it means something to me. And I always put this example that I think it's a great example because it illustrates how much I respect my teachers, but it also speaks about what I eventually believe is our purpose. I said it with my father, but I could speak like right now about my kids. Like I'll use as an example of Max, who paints very sweet paintings. Like he paints beauty. Or let's even go like to an extreme, which I think like Jeremy Lipkin, for example. Jeremy's like a crazy good painter and he paints beautifully. He sees beauty in things. Like I don't have that. I have like butcher hands. I just don't. I have like Lucian Freud goggles on. And for me, it's very, very hard to see softness and to see these very kind of attenuated versions of what I'm looking. When I'm looking at something, I see like scars and wrinkles, and I find them amazing. Those things I find beautiful. But let's say my daughter, who is absolutely beautiful, of course, I'm seeing her through my eyes, and I'm painting my daughter. I have to believe that even though I can't paint as beautifully as Jeremy does, I have to be able to speak about something that he can't. I have to be able to understand that if I decide to paint my daughter, it's a better painting of my daughter than any painting he could ever do. And the sole reason being that she's my daughter. And for me, this was really, really empowering. When I put it in those terms, and I've spoken about it in terms of my father who passed away, or my son and daughter, like, you know, it's not that they belong to me. It's not that this could be because it's my father or my son and daughter, but it's because the meaning of them in my life is so profound that there's no way that anyone could ever teach me about them through their work. There's no way. So I started to understand that is so powerful that why paint something that's somebody else's? You know, why do something that can be somebody else's or that stems from somebody else's experience? It just doesn't make sense to me anymore. So I had to, you know, I started looking within in like the simplest moments of my life, you know, the most mundane moments of my life. And I'm not even trying to speak about the mundane, like if it was something conceptual. I'm just seeing my life. That's about it. It's almost like I took a step back and I realized how all this time I've been kind of fighting within the art world, within the expectations of the art world, and with all the pressure that's put on you as a painter in the art world. And I said, no, I don't want this. I just don't need this anymore. Like, I understood myself as a painter without those things. Like, I realized, you know, if I take all of those things out, if I don't think as an artist, am I still able to paint? And my answer was yes, of course, because that's the way I understand things. That's the way I see things. That's the way I kind of explain things to myself. That's the way I have conversations with things. You know, that's the way I kind of put my perceptions to test and my biases to test and, you know, what I think I understand, what I think I believe. And I know myself as a painter because I have to say those things through painting. I can't say them through verbally. I can't say them through words. I can't, you know, but I can totally, you know, speak through drawing and speak through painting. And I realized I could speak about something that doesn't have to insert itself into the expectations of institutions or the art galleries, schools, nothing like that. So that was a big change for me.
Yeah, it feels a lot like, oh my God, and I cannot believe I can't remember where this came from, but I think it might have been Thoreau, but the quote about, or the concept of, almost like the hero's travels, you know, where this is in the context of exploring the world and, you know, literal hero travels, I guess, and going out and only finding yourself once you get back home.
Right, right. Exactly. Yeah. For me, it was very important to just kind of put that baggage down and say, I'm feeling very light now and I have no reason to answer to any of these things. But I can find, you know, solace, but also I can find, it's almost like this window to an incredibly exciting world just was always right there. But I was just refusing to look through it and not even open it because I thought my pretensions as an artist were lying elsewhere. And they were It was like, this is far more important than my son and daughter. Like, my art has to be something that's far deeper and far more reaching than just speaking about my kids. And I can't agree with that anymore. Like, it is, you know, speaking about my kids in a way, but I guess it speaks about, you know, me and the space I occupy and, you know, the thoughts I have and how I try to make sense of them and all these things through painting. That's the most important part. Like, I'm willing to have all these conversations with myself through painting. So that was huge for me, huge. And it changed everything. And this happened like a couple of years ago, but it did change my mindset and it was perfect. It was exactly what I needed.
Mm.
I don't know if it works for everyone. I've never like implied that that has to be everyone's journey.
Right.
But it worked for me. I know what is true for me. And maybe other people are like, you know, now I want to actually be part of like the gallery circuit and make a ton of money because I actually really like to make money doing the stuff I like to do. And if that's your path, then that's awesome. Like, go for it. It's just that I realized that the things that were at the core that were important for me were quite different from a lot of like other painters, and especially from the painting that I had been doing for a while. So I had to change.
Mm-hmm. On a more practical level, not that what you said wasn't practical, but on a very strictly practical level, I'm curious because I get this question, you know, kind of often. What did you experience moving from New York back to Bogota? And I guess the question behind the question is, you know, the people who listen to this podcast are from all over the world, and there's a sort of perception that you have to be in New York or a major metropolis in order to make it. And I'd love to hear your perspective on that concept.
Yeah, a short answer, no, that's not true. But the long-winded answer would be, I'm not going to try to make it long-winded, but when I got back here, I hated it. You know, I saw everything that was not New York in Bogota. And I thought, you know, this is a smaller art scene. It's very narrow-minded. The cultural explosion that you can sense every single day when you're in New York, it's nothing here. I couldn't get, you know, good paint. I couldn't get good brushes here. I couldn't get, you know, a good piece of canvas. I couldn't get anything here. And so I was just resentful. You know, I questioned my decision. I was like, why did I do this? This was so stupid. Like, coming back to a country that's undeniably like poor, where everything is going to be harder to get. And it just doesn't make sense. Like, what was I doing? I was like in New York. Like, that's what you're supposed to be if you're
right.
Like, if you make it there, then that's amazing. You just existing in that city just makes you this triumphant, like hero, you know, you made it just because you can be there like day to day. And you've withstood like everything that's tough about living in a place like that. And I did love it. I mean, I still absolutely love that city, but you know, I consider myself like a New Yorker. Like if I had to, you know, I was born in Wisconsin and, you know, I've never felt like I'm like a Midwest. No, never in my life. And Bogota is actually like a really big city. It's like a super, super big city. But I you know, I always felt like I was big, big city. I love that. I love to walk. I love public transportation. I love people in the streets. I love everything about that. So of course, for me, New York is like my home. But as soon as I got here, yeah, just pure resentment. And I thought, I'm never going to be able to do anything here. There's no money here. There's no market here. It's like everyone's stupid. Everyone doesn't even know what they're talking about. Like nobody's sophisticated. You know, everything that's human, like a human reaction I had.
Mm-hmm.
And I had to tell myself like, okay, maybe lash out for like half an hour more and then just stop. Stop and you're back. That's not going to change. You're not going to go back to New York. So just now that you're back, like do something. Work within, you know, whatever you have here. And it was the best thing that I could have ever done. Like I realized there are limitations here. There are tons of limitations here. There's tons of problems here. I mean, that are endemic to like Colombia and Bogota. But everywhere in the world, you know, there's no perfect place. That doesn't exist. And I realized that I could work from from what was available to me here. So if I had to paint with like cheaper paints, then I would. If I had to paint with like really crappy brushes, then I would. If I had to paint on like really bad canvas, then I would. It didn't matter. I learned to understand that painting did not reside in my materials or how expensive they were, and that I could create my own market. I could, you know, sometimes we as artists, sometimes we do incredibly good job, but we expect the gallery to call us. We expect people to say, you know, I just saw your Instagram page and you're so amazing. And I just want to throw money at your face. And I just want to tell you, like, do whatever you want. And we're going to buy all of it. And we're going to do, you know, for 5 years, we're going to buy all anything you do and just do whatever you want. We're idiots about those things. Truth is, you have to look for those spaces. You have to create those spaces.
How did you create that in Bogota?
Just going from small, maybe to big. I realized that I had to start somewhere. So I started with a smaller gallery. Even back then, when I was having my first shows that we didn't have like social media like right now, I was very keen in trying to go to places and talk about what I was doing and show other people my work, you know, not the whole of my show, but just enough so that they could get excited and just to create a buzz around everything. And, you know, it was amazing. Like, I've understood, and this is like remarkable, but that people will follow you. It doesn't matter. Like nowadays, people, you know, you could be showing in a garage. People don't care if you're in Gagosian or David Zwirner, or if you're showing in a damn garage and people love your work, they will show up. They will do it. It doesn't matter. We have to understand that those things, of course, they have weight. Like, you know, if David Zwirner called me right now, I'd be like, Antrice, I gotta go. Sorry.
Click. I'll explain later.
Yeah, and you're probably never going to hear from me again because my head is so big that I just can't.
I can tell.
But yeah, that would happen. But the truth is, people actually, they can respond to you. If you engage people, and if you, in my case, people have become such an important part of what I do, that just the presence of them and their comments and their reactions and just understanding that they are accompanying me through this path has been so amazing. It's been incredible. And I never, even if it was different back then, I never saw things like differently. Like, even if the, like I said, the tools that we had back then were not, you know, the same ones we have right now, that we could just promote the hell out of a show through Facebook and Twitter and Instagram. I didn't have that, but I've always loved to connect with people. I love it. And that's why I do workshops, and I love meeting people, and I'm super comfortable. But I did that, and I always felt that that was important. I couldn't just kind of lay back and say, you know what, just come and buy, you know, buy stuff. And no, you can't have that attitude. You have to push. You have to do like the legwork. You can't ask of people things that you're not willing to put in yourself. You know, you can't just tell them, you know, oh, make a great effort because this painting is, I don't know, whatever, like $20,000. So you probably have $20,000 to pay for this. No, you know, if you're asking so much of people, you have to like be willing to put in as much as the effort that they would have to put to buy something from you. I've really felt that's our responsibility.
Did you feel like you had to change your prices when you went to Bogota?
Yeah, I guess I had to contextualize my prices.
Yeah, because it's a totally...
Yeah, exactly, which is exactly as just changing my prices. But I'm saying contextually because, you know, there's a market that you can't expect it to behave in one way. You know, if the truth of the matter is, if you're selling something in Bogota and then you expect to go to, I don't know, Dubai and sell that, you know, you're expected to sell it for more. It just makes sense. But I never felt like it had to, like nowadays, I just have a price. You know, not nowadays, I'm at a point where just things are worth X. And many times when people ask me for a price here in Bogota, I'll say it in dollars. You know, it's just, that's a universal price. In a sense, I had to understand myself a little bit differently and say, okay, but, you know, I may feel like, let's say, I may feel like this small painting is worth $3,000, let's say. But in reality, maybe one person, a couple of people are going to pay $3,000 for this painting here in Bogota. But maybe if I say 1,000, that would be the same feeling I had when I was in New York saying I'm worth 3,000. In here, it would be like I'm worth 1,000. So you have to step down. Again, it's about being humble and understanding that, okay, maybe you're not going to make as much money as you would have wanted, but you have to start somewhere. You have to build something. And it's not, I've always understood that it's not about, you know, having that one person pay you, you know, let's say $50,000, but I'd much rather have 50 people paying $1,000 than one idiot that can pay $50,000 and can make me a bigger idiot for thinking that I'm worth $50,000. So if you have 50 that are willing to pay $1,000, that's like, wow, this is crazy. This is a ton of people are willing to support what I do. And the other one is just me thinking, I just want to land on whomever is willing to just give me what I want. And you're feeling like you're being more intelligent about it. You're like, you're feeling kind of sneaky about it and you're proud of being like sneaky about it. And that's not, there's no worth in that. Nothing can beat the fact that people can support you consistently. That's amazing. For me, that's been my whole process. And I've done hundreds upon hundreds of paintings. Well, I don't know, that sounded like really weird, but I've done hundreds and hundreds of paintings. And, you know, if you come to my studio, I just have, you know, I'm so lucky to have just the stuff that I'm working on currently. A lot of times people are like, can you send us all the stuff you have available? And I'm like, this is it. Like, this is all I have. And that's awesome to me. Like, to be able to say, it was more important for me to find like people that were happy just wanting something of mine and, you know, making big efforts in trying to pay for those things. I felt so proud and honored, you know, that people would want my work to be part of their lives, that I always realized, like, I want that. I want that feeling. I want the feeling that I can feel like I'm part of what they have also kind of given me. Like, it's an instant connection between like your audience and yourself. So yeah, just start small, be humble, be patient. Usually in the art world, when things happen very quickly, they also like go up in flames very quickly, because the art world can inflate artists and then they don't really care about what happens to them in the future. They just throw them out and find somebody else again to like push those prices and sell and resell. And that's not good. If you want to do this for the rest of your life, just go slow and be patient. And I know that's not what we want to hear, because a lot of us, sometimes life is like tough and we have to make, you know, we live like day to day, month to month, and we pay rent and, you know, it is tough. And sometimes we say, I just need money. You know, it sounds good and all, but I just need money. But honestly, like if we can look beyond that small moment of struggle that we're having and think that what we're building is for the rest of our lives, then we can kind of convince ourselves that we will take the time. And that's what I did. And I slowly built myself here. I went from a smaller gallery to a medium-sized gallery to a really big gallery. You know, they took me to shows and biennials, and they started showing my work in like South, not only in here in Bogota, but then in South America, but then in Central America and Mexico, but then in Spain, but then in the US, and everything started like expanding, and that's awesome. And to be honest, like right now in my life, like I feel super comfortable here in Bogota, and I wouldn't change it for the world. And I realized that I can show anywhere, but I want to be here. You know, even if 15 years ago, I thought coming back was the biggest failure of my life and I hated everything I saw. Nowadays, I'm like, no, this just being here taught me to be patient and taught me to be grateful for what I have available and taught me to work within these boundaries. And that is far greater than anything that, any lesson that painting had ever given me up to that point.
Nicolas, thank you so much. That was wonderful.
Thank you, Entries.
Well, I hope you enjoyed this episode of the Savvy Painter podcast with the artist Nicolas Uribe. Go to savvypainter.com for show notes on this episode. You can see examples of Nicolas's work, get links to every artist that we talked about, and connect with Nicolas. And I'd like to give a big thank you and a shout out to some of the artists who helped bring you the Savvy Painter podcast. Big or small, your contribution helps keep the podcast going. If you've been inspired by some of the artists you've heard here on the Savvy Painter podcast and would like to contribute, just go to savvypainter.com/support. Thank you so much to Lauren Everett Finn, Linda Brandon, Andrea DePreter, Frederick Marsh, Bitsy Broughton, Elizabeth Rommel, Matthew Long, Vincent Keeling, Chris Rearing, Sandra Thompson, Gloria Chow, Beverly Hayes, Julian Davis, Matthew Peterson, Paul Rost, Beth Riley, Carla Roth, Debbie Bird Paintings, Diane McGee, Diana Wells, Jamie Kirkland Fine Art, Jillian Lauren Licitano, Joan Greer, Jordan Wolfson, Kenneth Burke, Kristen Kronick, Leslie Gerhardt, Lucinda Kasser, Raquel Kramer, Robin Delaney, Stephanie Drotti, and Tracy Lee Morgan. Thank you so much, and I'm so grateful for your support. You keep this podcast going and help other artists to make their impact.
So until the next time, this is Antrese Wood with the Savvy Painter podcast. Thank you so much for listening.